So today I want to share with you something that's very, it's very close to my heart because it's something that my wife and I, we continuously go through, and this change is so much a part of our lives. I've entitled this talk, All Things Ordinary. All Things Ordinary. I'll talk today from Deuteronomy 6, 4 to 9, but let me tell you a little bit about what I mean when I say all things ordinary. We realize that as Christians, when we mature in the Lord, most of our Christian life is really the mundane and the ordinary. In fact, when I planned and tried to plan my life and the Lord slowly was calling me into ministry, our founding pastor at the time, nung nagka-counseling po kami, he told me, and I can never ever forget this, he told me this, he said, you know, the biggest opposition that any pastor or any minister or any Christian for that matter would face is the opposition of life. Simply because you're a Christian, it does not mean that your bills automatically get paid. Because you're a Christian, it does not mean that the electric bill gets paid, the water bill gets paid, that automatic the kids go to school. You have to engage life and work. No matter how much you believe in God, He's given you arms and legs and strength and energy, so you put yourself to work. And that's the biggest challenge of any minister. Dahil as you're giving toward a congregation, you're also trying to balance family life. And you realize that most of the Christian journey is made up of ordinary things, the mundaneness of life. You work 8 to 5. Maybe you're here, you work an 8 to 5 job, or kung call center po kayo, you work odd hours. But regardless of that, pag uwi nyo, if you're a housewife, kayo pa po yung magluluto, right? If you have kids, you set the table before your husband comes home. If your kids are little, you give them a bath, give them a shower, you load the laundry. And these are the things you cannot say, Lord, in faith, this laundry is going to be clean. Hindi po mangyayari yun. No matter how much faith you have, the fabric softener and the soap is not going to float into the laundry and it's going to dry itself. You can pray for the sun to come out in the morning, sure. But these are part and parcel of the life that you and I live, whether you're a Christian or not. And I realized this growing up. I even had this prayer before, Lord, my best days and my blessed days are ahead of me. Pero ang pakiramdam ko, Lord, but parang yung best tsaka yung blessed, I don't feel it. I go through life every single day and it's the same thing and it's a cycle. It goes again and again. And you don't feel the blessed and the best days. There's still dishes to wash. There's still kids to put through school. There's still the laundry that does not clean itself. There's still the bills. And ang sabi ko po nga sa earlier service today, I said, imagine how ruthless our bills come. Our bills, they keep coming on time. They imagine if you told Meralco, sir, can we pay you in installment? And Meralco says, sure, but we'll give you your electricity in installment also. So, disco po yung bahay nyo kasi installment din yung... Hindi naman po pwede yun. My point is, as a Christian, your calling is to engage life. You can be a great preacher, a great pastor, a great elder, a small group leader, a CEO of a company. Life is there for you to engage in. It's all things ordinary. And I want to show you a very simple diagram about our life. I think many Christians fail in this dahil tayo minsan, we focus so much on the dramatic things. If you're a single person, Lord, when will the clouds part and you'll write the name of the man that I'm supposed to marry? I want to see it. I want to hear your voice, Lord, when I open the Word of God. I want you to clearly tell me what my calling is for my life. Those are the extraordinary days. Those are the dramatic days. You know, that only happens once a while. Most of our life, we live in the mundane. What's the mundane? It's the everyday life. You wash dishes, pay bills, hatid sundo yung mga anak niyo sa school, you go to work, and yet, every month, feeling mo kulang pa rin. Hindi po ba? Can we relate to that? Kulang pa rin, utang pa rin. Minsan nga, yung iba po sa atin, yung sinesweldo, dumidiretso na po sa utang. Right? And sometimes you just wanna tell the company, is it okay if you just pay my yung utang ko directly na lang kasi hindi ko naman po nararamdaman yung dumadaan po sa kamay ko. Can you just pay them straight para I don't have to worry? Bayad utang na lang po. But that's the reality of where we live today. This is the reality. But this is so important for us, and we have to realize this. The mundane is the place you become most like Jesus. And yet we focus on the dramatic things of life. Lord, where can I see the miracles? And where can I see the blessing and the promotion and the expansion? And then as Christians, we become bitter sometimes because our brothers and our sisters are getting blessed and tayo hindi. Imagine in the prayer group, you come to the Lord and you say, you know, I have prayer requests. We really need financial help. We really need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then may ibang brother and sister ka in the Lord saying, Pastor, you know, can you dedicate my house? Can you dedicate my car? Say, go, Lord, may house, may car. Ako, wala akong ma-dedicate. I'll just dedicate my life to you. How come you're blessing them and Lord, you're not blessing me? How come their story is grand? Their story is full of miracles and my story is so bland? And I've talked to so many people about this. They've grown bitter in church. They complain about the mundaneness of life, but they don't realize that it's in the mundaneness of life that you become more like Jesus Christ. And when you remain faithful in engaging everyday life, you learn to appreciate the dramatic that comes once in a while. Dahil faithful po tayo in the mundane, you will never miss the dramatic and the extraordinary days that come once in a while. So whenever I talk to young people and we talk about being faithful in reading the Bible or doing your devotions, and they say, but Pastor Brian, every time you do your devotions, it's like, you know, every time you hear from the Lord. I said, no, on the contrary. Out of the 10 times I open my Bible, maybe there will be one time that will be so extraordinary. But my calling is to be faithful to get to the Word every single day. Because those once in a while moments, they're always life-changing. And they're always worth it. My calling is to show up every day and do it every day. Not to complain. Not to shake our fists at the Lord and say, Lord, why? But to work and apply myself to where the Lord has called me. Are we following? In church, the dramatic events are the camps, the conferences, where you get to experience a spiritual high and then you come back home and that spiritual high, all of a sudden, it crashes because you're faced with the realities of life. But you see, the truth is what you get in the spiritual highs is what equips you to live out the mundane, to live out everyday life, pay the bills, take care of your wife, your husband. Some of you are caring for your parents. You have many kids, so you're caring for your kids. This is the calling of the mundaneness of life. Please allow me to present to you 3 Bible characters, and I just want to build on this foundation, and then we're going to talk about the main verse in Deuteronomy. Here's the first Bible character that I want to introduce to you. It's Moses. All of you know Moses. Imagine the blessing and the grace and the power of the life of Moses. He grew up in a society na every little boy his age, pinapapatay po, they were being killed. And by the providence of God and the wisdom of his mom, put him in a basket. And he ends up in Egypt under the very care of the people that wanted to destroy him. And out of the providence of God, the Lord uses the resources of the enemy to raise him up. He has the best education. He has the best of whatever best he can get out of life because he was raised under Egypt. Can you imagine how the Lord was moving in Moses' life early on palang? So Moses grew up in Egypt. Whatever leadership abilities and leadership skills, it was deposited to him early in his life. But as Moses grew up, he realized that he was really an Israelite, not an Egyptian. One day he was walking and he sees how the Egyptians were persecuting and beating his fellow people. He ends up killing this Egyptian dahil sa takot niya po. He runs away out of the place of royalty into a place of poverty. So Moses runs away, and this is what happens. Let me read to you the story in Exodus 3, 1 to 2. It says in Exodus 3, 1 to 2, now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. Imagine, from being a person of royalty, he ends up a shepherd. And the sheep that he's watching, hindi pa po sa kanya. He did not own the sheep that he was watching. And here's what happened. And he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. My question to you is this. Where did Moses find his calling in life? Was it in royalty in Egypt or in the faithfulness of the workplace? In the workplace. Because he was in the wilderness and he had sheep to watch, and he said, okay, Lord, I'm going to be a shepherd if this is what you're calling me to be. Every day of my life, I'm going to watch the sheep. And true enough, as he remained faithful to take the sheep out every single day, one day, the Lord shows up. But that one day changes the very landscape of his life. But where did Moses find his calling? Was it in a church? Was it inside a growing Bible-believing community? No, it was found in the mundaneness of life, in the faithfulness of engaging everyday life. You find the voice of God. And I want to make that clear. Because sometimes we come to the Lord and we say, God, I want to serve you in big ways. I want to be a pastor. I want to be a missionary. I want to hear the words, good and faithful servant, at the end of my life. But you realize that the good and faithful servant is for the single mom. It's for the faithful dad. It's for the person that has engaged life faithfully and has found the calling of God to do it with all their heart. And that's how Moses found it. You know, honestly, if there was a burning bush in Egypt, I don't think Moses would even draw near to it. Why? Because Egypt had wealth and prosperity, and there were many sparkling things in Egypt. He would not have seen the burning bush. But God had to remove him from that place, put him in the wilderness to learn to be faithful where he has called him. And that day came, sabi ni Lord sa kanya from the bush, Moses, right now you're watching a few sheep. I want to increase your influence. Your influence will no longer be a few sheep, but I'm raising up a deliverer in you. And I want you to influence 1 million people and call them out of Egypt. I have to first deliver you before you can be a deliverer to others. And Moses, the rest is history. He goes to Egypt and calls out the very people that God has loved so much. And the rest we know. But Moses found his calling in the workplace where God has called you and I. Are we following? Yes? It's so difficult sometimes to accept the season that the Lord has placed us in. And encouragement sa atin na ibang tao is, sige brother, sige sister, maybe that's just a season, but you've been in that season for 10, 15 years and you're saying, Lord, parang hindi nagbabago yung season ko. I'm doing this again and again and again and again. Where are you in all of this? But you keep at it faithfully, and I promise you, by God's grace, in that place, as you remain faithful in little, He will make you ruler over much. Let me show you another Bible character, Elisha. Let me give you a quick background on Elisha. I'm just laying the foundation. Elisha was the prophet that replaced Elijah. Now, that's a lot of pressure. You know why? Because kung titignan po natin ang resume ni Elijah, Elijah was one of the greatest Old Testament prophets. This man called down fire from heaven, one against 400 prophets of Baal. Can you imagine? Tas ikaw yung magiging replacement nitong taong ito. So now, Elijah was on the run because he was in a point in his life na discouraged po siya. Because the very queen of the land was trying to kill him. So Elijah runs away, approaches this mountain, and in that mountain, the Lord talks to him. And the Bible describes it as a supernatural experience. There was a mighty earthquake, there was a fire, there was a wind. But the Bible says the Lord was not in any of these things. And then the Lord tells him, Moses, come out of the cave. And then the word of God actually says, it was a gentle whisper that Elijah heard from God. And I think that's where a lot of Christians are. Sometimes we focus on the grandeur of things. We look for the fires and the earthquakes, and we look for all the winds in life because we want the big signs of God. We want to have confirmations. Can I tell you this? You know, that's an Old Testament thing. Just like Gideon, when the angel appeared to Gideon, you mighty man of valor. What did Gideon say? Okay, Lord, if you're really calling me, I am going to test you on this, and you got to prove yourself. He brought out some fleece. If the fleece is wet or dry, he said, Lord, you have to show me first before I actually jump in. You know, in the New Testament, it's different. The New Testament, we're taught to act out in faith. In the New Testament, you live out your faith, and the confirmations, they follow after. The signs and wonders, they follow after. As you step out in faith and say, God, I believe that you're calling me to do this, and I'm going to do it. And the confirmations, they come later on in your life, and you realize, wow, God, as I stepped out in faith, this thing happened, and this thing happened, and this thing happened. This is really where you're calling me to be. What did Elijah do? The Lord told Elijah, Elijah, I want you to go back the way you came. And I want you to look for a successor. Look for Elisha. Here's my question. Where did Elijah find Elisha? Was it in the church? Was it in the Bible-believing community where he was actively involved? Let me show you where Elijah found Elisha. In 1 Kings 19:19, so he departed, meaning Elijah, he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and with the 12, Elijah passed by him and cast the cloak upon him. Where was Elisha? He was working. To him, ganito lang po kasimple. Sabi niya, yung mga magulang ko may lupa. So ang calling ko as a son is to plow the ground. And when it's time to harvest, I'm gonna harvest. When it's time to plant, magtatanim ako. Because this is where I'm called to be. You don't see any verse of Elisha daydreaming, one day I'm gonna be a prophet. Papalitan ko yung si Elijah. Kung siya fire lang from heaven, ako ice and fire and rain. Kayang-kaya ko yan. But you see, where Elisha was, is that he was faithful in the mundaneness of life. Lord, dito mo ko tinawag. I will plow the ground faithfully with my family because we own this piece of land. And I'm going to be faithful at this day in and day out. That is where Elisha finds his calling. And you and I, we have to understand this as believers. Minsan nakafocus tayo sa grandeur. We want the miracles. Lalo na po, if you're the type of person that actually hears a lot of testimonies of people and you hear a lot of miraculous testimonies and you're wondering, Lord, ba't yung buhay niya puro miracles? Yung sa akin parang napaka-ordinary. But the truth is, if you live with that person, every single day, there are challenges in that person's life. There is no person alive today that is challenge-free. In fact, a pastor said it this way, the Bible never guarantees us a storm-free life, but the Bible teaches us how to live storm-proof. That's a different thing. That the storms will come in your life, mga pagsusubok po ay darating sa buhay natin, but because Christ lives in you, you can fight that storm. You can go through and through that storm and be stronger. And this is how Elisha found his calling. And if you know Elisha's story, he was the prophet with the double portion of God's anointing. The rest is history. But he found his calling plowing the field, engaging life. I think ang failure po natin bilang Kristiyano if we stop engaging life and we say, okay, Lord, pagod na ako. I throw in the towel. I'm done. I can't deal with my kids anymore. I can't deal with my marriage anymore. I can't deal with my work. So I just quit. I quit. Because life is too hard. But the Lord is teaching you today, the mundaneness of your life, those are the classroom days. That's where you become most like Jesus. And that's what makes the difference. Now let me show you another Bible character. This is the last of the three. Consider David. David, this young shepherd boy who was also called the man after God's own heart. One day the Lord talks to the prophet Samuel and says, Samuel, I want you to go to the house of Jesse and I want you to anoint the next king of Israel. Ang problema po, Samuel was still mourning Saul because the Spirit of God had departed from Saul. And when Jesse paraded each of his sons in front of Samuel, imagine, they did not even consider David to be a candidate to be a king one day. Where was David? I want to show you where David was. Here's the verse. Then Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? And he said, there remains the youngest. But behold, he is keeping the sheep. Where was David when he found his grand calling in his life? He was faithfully keeping the sheep where God called him to keep. Did you know it was in his keeping the sheep that he became the sweet psalmist of Israel? Did you know that it was in keeping the sheep that he learned to kill the lion and the bear that became his preparation to defeat the giant that defied the armies of the living God? Because the mundaneness of life is the school day that will prepare you for the dramatic victories that the Lord is giving you. And the biggest victory of David when he killed Goliath, it came about because of his faithfulness as a son. What was the story? One early morning, the father tells David, David, I want you to bring this food. Itong baon, dalhin mo sa mga kapatid mo in the battlefield. Ano sabi ni David? Tay, excuse me ha. Didn't you see the other day, lumuhod ako, inanoint ako ni Samuel. Ikaw ang magdala niyan sa mga kapatid mo. Sa mga anak mo. Did you read that in the Bible? But you see, David, as a faithful son, he said, yes, Dad, I will take that food to my brothers in the battlefield. And it was when David was taking that food that he hears Goliath defy the armies of the living God. And you know, the rest is history. It was also David that ends up killing that giant. And he himself becomes a great giant in the land that people started to chant his name. And that prepared him to become king one day. And how did that come about? He became a faithful son to his father. And sometimes that's as simple as our calling can be. Where you are now, Pastor, I'm a teenager. What's my calling? You finish school. And you be faithful at it. No, but Pastor, I mean calling, like I want to change the world. No, you finish school because that's where the Lord put you. You be faithful in that and watch the Lord prepare you for the bigger and grander things. Pastor, I just graduated. You know, I really want to be in ministry. I want to do this. I want to accomplish this. You go get a job. No, but Pastor, I want to plant a church. I want to go to the poorest of the poor. I want to see the seas part. I want to see the clouds part. I want to see the miracles of your life. No, I want you to be faithful where I called you to be. And watch my miracles from there, because I will establish you as a person. I will grow your character as a person. Because if I promote you in leadership without expanding your character, you're going to ruin the plans that I have for you. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to grow your character and then grow your influence and then grow your leadership so that you have the internal structures to stand when temptation comes at that place in leadership. See, that's how the Lord operates. He will operate at that level, but our calling is not to compare where our life is. It's not to point fingers, but it's to be faithful where God has called us to be. Amen? And that's easier said than done. Lord, my husband is such a difficult person to live with. Lord, my wife, Panginoon, kunin niyo na siya, oh God. Ngayon na, Lord. Wag next week. Ngayon na, Panginoon. Ang hirap niyang pakisamahan. But you're married. And the Lord says, I want you to be faithful where I called you to be. And watch me work in your family and in your home where you are. I just wanted to lay a foundation for this next verse that we read earlier in Deuteronomy. Let me read it from 6:4-9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments I give you today are to be on your hearts. Let me pause there. And I think this is a very honest prayer by many Christians. Lord, all I want is to love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. I want to be a pastor. I want to be a rich businessman so that I can support missionaries across the world. Lord, this is the place where I can love you the most. Lord, I want to be a person that disciples others. I want to be a person that people look up to. Because Lord, pakiramdam ko in this church, this is where I can love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Ito yung application nito. Lord, help me to do this. But if we go back to this verse, look at how this verse is applied. Look at what it says. These commandments that I give you today are to be in your hearts. Look at the next verse. Impress them on your children and talk about them when you sit at where? At home. What the Bible is saying is that the greatest application to love the Lord with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and strength is not in the church, is not in the mission field, it's in the home. Because you cannot be a great missionary and a bad husband. You cannot be a great pastor and a bad wife. Hindi po pwede. That's not the design of God. The faithfulness is measured in the home. Lord, I want to love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Okay, be a good husband. Be a good father. Be a good wife. Be a good mother. Lord, baka naman may mas magandang pwede kong gawin sa labas. Ang hirap sa bahay. Gusto ko, Lord, doon. Because doon, that's where I come alive. That's where I can love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. But you see, the first commandment, it's hinged on home management. No, anak, you will shine the brightest. That before you stand in the pulpit, you learn to lead the prayer in the table. Before you preach God in the pulpit, you learn to break bread with your family and you be the husband that I called you to be. Before you do great things, feeding programs, reaching the lost for Jesus, I want you to make a difference in your children. Impress them on your children. And I think a lot of Christians, we miss that because home management is so mundane. It's the one bill to the next. It's the deadlines of the tuition fees. It's parating pa lang yung summer, yung ibang parents, kinakabahan na ako, tataas na naman yung kuryente namin. Dahil wala nang gagawin itong mga anak natin kundi matulog. Yung ref, kago-grocery ko lang, pagbukas ko, kala mo nag-defrost, naubos na. Kasi kain ng kain, lalo na if you have teenagers, kain ng kain. Dad, wala bang pagkain dyan. Son, I just bought grocery. It's gone. And then ikaw yung breadwinner. As you're shoveling in the money, your kids and your wife is shoveling it out. Lord, that's the mundaneness of life. But if you're faithful there, it trains you to become faithful outside. Let me continue this verse. Look what it says here. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols in your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on the gates. Of course, the Jews took this literally. They would bind it. I've been to Israel and I watched the Jews do this. But you see, if we take this spiritual lesson, it's powerful. That the very symbols are written on your hands. Why? Because when you start to serve others, it always reminds you, anak, you're loving me with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Write it on the door frames of your houses, meaning the house is the best place where you can love me with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Training ground mo yan, anak. So the way I am at home will make me shine brightest. Who I am in private will make me shine brightest in public. And I think that's where many, many of us, we make the mistake and we fail in that, even as pastors. And feeling ko po, isang pagkakamali yan ng ibang mga pastor. I'm not saying that I'm perfect. I'm very far from perfect. Very far. But I think one of the biggest mistakes that pastors make is that they start the church, they do overtime in church, they spend very little time with their family, and ang prayer nila kay Lord is, Lord, because I'm doing your ministry, can you make up for the time at home for me? Lord, yung hindi ko kaya ibigay na oras doon dahil nandito ako busy para sa inyo, pwedeng Lord, kayo na bahala sa pamilya ko. I think that's a very wrong thinking. I think it should be the other way around. When you've done whatever you can do here, as a church leader, you go back to your family and say, Lord, whatever time I can't give there, would you help me in the church? Would you help me with the congregation? Why? Because it's the Bible that says it. Upon this rock, I will build my... The pastor is not in charge of building the church. The Lord says, I'm in charge of building the church. And we neglect family in the name of ministry, and that's dangerous. We neglect family in the name of work. We neglect family in the name of so many things. But this is the place where you become more like Christ. We have to be careful. And it has to be a lesson that comes again and again. Lalo na po sa aming mga lalaki. We get so wired when we're working. We get so focused when we're out here. When we come home, we don't want anyone to bother us because that's how we are as guys. But we have to train ourselves. We cannot neglect this and hope to grow this when the Lord is in charge of building His church and we're just His messengers to make that happen. Let me show you my last example. None other than Jesus Christ. How did Jesus endure the cross? How are you and I enduring the trials and the difficulties in the mundaneness of life? Yung mga kulang pa rin, yung inuuwing sweldo, how do you endure that? Lord, hindi na ba matatapos to? The Bible says in Hebrews 12 verse 2, looking to Jesus, of course, that's rule number one. You set your eyes not on your brother and your sister, but on Jesus. Hindi naman pwede and that we're always comparing. Magkano ba yung sinesweldo ni Ganyan? Bakit yung sweldo ko ganito lang? Lord, mas Kristiyano pa nga ako sa kanya eh. Bakit yung sweldo niya? Diba? Sometimes we complain. We have to be careful. Because that's the mundaneness of life. Look what it says. The founder and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. How did Jesus endure the cross? He learned to set his eyes on future joy. Let me say that again. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Dahil nakita ni Jesus yung future joy, yung pinagdadaanan niya ngayon will bring about a joy found in the future. It brought him endurance to live out the present. Tayo as Christians, it should be the same. Lord, tong pinagdadaanan ko parang wala na pong katapusan. It never ends. But Lord, my joy is anchored not on this present circumstance, but on the joy of the future. That one day, when I breathe my last, my next breath, I'll take it face to face in heaven with you. And that gives me endurance to live out the present. And It gives you and I the power to despise the shame, despise the pain, to despise the suffering. Why? Because you understand that the anchor of your soul is none other than Jesus Christ. So whatever shaking comes your way, hindi Lord, alam kong matatapos din to. Ang utang mababayaran din to eh. Ang paghihirap dito, matatapos din. Ang kakulangan dito, matatapos din. Bakit? Lord, you live inside me. The Holy Spirit is inside me. I have everything I need in life and godliness to live out this life faithfully. And then you realize that as you slay the giants of your life, you yourself, you become a giant also. And you start to increase and expand. Your faith begins to grow. Your prayer begins to change. The way you read the Bible begins to change. And so many things in your life, the Lord is growing you. When you look back, all you can say is, I only survived because God has been faithful in my life. Sa totoo lang po, lahat ng pastor, wala naman po kaming maipagyayabang. Sa totoo lang, whether you have a degree or not, we stand here only because of the faithfulness of God. To step down from the pulpit is to be able to practice what we've preached, and only God's grace can keep us to do that. Wala ho tayong may pagmamayabang. All of us, we live under, we stand under the same ground, level ground. I want to end with this quote. It's a very powerful quote. It's also a question for you and I. Pastor Paul Tripp, he writes this: if God doesn't rule your mundane, then he doesn't rule you. So my question to you is, when you have dishes to wash and laundry to load, clothes to iron, kids to take care of, who rules your heart? Are you full of complaining? When you have a salary that does not meet the standards that you want for your family, and you complain, who rules your heart? Because that's part of the mundaneness of life. And when you learn to be faithful there, it's the only time the Lord begins to say, okay, anak, I think you're ready for a promotion. Okay, anak, I think you're ready for the increase. Because I know when I increase you, you become a channel of blessing to others. You don't hoard, you bless. And let me continue what it says. Because, sabi ni Paul, Pastor Paul Tripp, because that's where you and I live. Dramatic life-altering moments come only once a few times during our lifetime. That's why they are called dramatic. Isn't that true? So today, I want to invite you to stand. If you would stand with me this morning. I want you to close your eyes. Now, as you close your eyes, I just want you to take this time to evaluate where you are, where your marriage is, where your family is, where your kids are. And I know it's so easy to find something to complain about. It's so easy. But today, I want to do it differently. As you close your eyes, I want you, with all your heart, to look for things to thank God for. Because where you are now, the difficulty that you face, it means the Lord is molding you and preparing you for something bigger. Even in the seasons, did you know the coldness of the winter, it dictates how hot the summer will be? So when you're in the cold of winter and it's painfully difficult where you are in your family life, in your marriage, as a single parent, as a single person, maybe you're taking care of your parents and hirap na kayong umusog in your life, where you are, when you learn to blossom there, that's when the Lord begins to expand you. Now with your eyes closed, I want to ask you this question. If you're here this morning, and may pinagdadaanan kang pagsusubok, whether it's a financial difficulty, maybe it's fear of being alone because you've been faithfully waiting and you so want to get married. Maybe you're a single parent. Your husband or your wife, they left you and you're left to fend off for your kids on your own. And lahat ng ginagawa mo, ang hirap na hirap ka na, kulang pa rin. Maybe you're a person that's sick in your body and it's just pulled you down from a roller coaster ride of encouragement and discouragement and encouragement and discouragement, and it's just pulling you down. I want you to raise your hands if that's you. You're going through something in this season, and it's like the season is never ending. Hallelujah, Lord. This is really between you and the Lord. It's not for me to see. It's just a sign of honesty to say, God, that's me. I want to love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, but it's just too difficult to apply that where I am. I don't make enough money. I don't know where the next bill, how the next bill is going to be paid. God, I don't know how this next checkup is going to go. God, I'm a single parent. I don't know how to do this alone. Ang hirap-hirap, Panginoon. I want you to raise that hand out of honesty. Thank you, Lord. Because this is the time that the Lord is teaching you to be faithful in the mundane, in everyday life. Now, with one hand raised, would you raise the other hand as well? That's a sign of surrender. Two hands up. Hallelujah. I want to pray for you today. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, to lift up our hand, even as a man, Lord, that affects our pride, that affects our ego many times. And Lord, to raise our hands to you and admit that we don't have it all figured out, that's difficult, God. But Lord, as we raise our hands today to the God that fights for us, to the God of all seasons, to the God who loves us like no other, Lord, it was you who said that, for I know the plans that I have for you. Lord, kami po, we have blind spots. We may not see those plans. But Lord, your word is sure. And your word says, anak, my child, my son, my daughter, I know the plans that I have for you. They are plans to prosper you. Lord, even if we cannot see and understand this season, Lord, your word is sure and unchanging. And your word says there are plans to prosper us, to give us a hope. Oh God, today, some of us, that's all that we need today. We need hope, God. Life has been so hard. We need hope. And Lord, what's wonderful is that it's not just hope, but it's a sure future. And only you can give that. Nobody is promised tomorrow. But Lord, you give us a sure future. So Lord, with our hands raised today, we just surrender every situation, all of our children, our financial difficulties, our physical ailments, God. And Lord, I pray, Lord, today, and Lord, we ask for forgiveness if we've been complaining with our lips. That Lord, in the mundaneness of life, all that comes out of our lips is complaint instead of worship, complaint instead of thanksgiving. But Lord, today we choose to thank you for expanding us, for making us more like Christ, for teaching us to live faithfully in the ordinary days. Because Lord, this is where we become more like you. So Lord, today these hands that are lifted up high, this is a sign not only of surrender, but also victory, God. That Lord, today, starting this day, Lord, we choose to be faithful where you've called us to be. Lord, yung iba po sa amin nag-iisip to even leave this country thinking that it will be better. But Lord, today, as your word assures us that we can bloom where we're planted, we can grow where we are today and see the faithfulness of God. So Lord, today, would you show yourself strong and mighty in every marriage? Every parent that's here, every young man, young woman that's here, show yourself mighty today. And Lord, we anchor our joy today, not on the circumstances of the present, but on the joy of the future. The joy that is in Christ, that's unchanging, that's unmoving, that's immeasurable. And Lord, nobody can take that joy away from us. So Lord, that today gives us endurance to live out this present life. Lord, we honor You and we worship You and we bless Your name. In Jesus' name, all God's people say, amen and amen.